after having just finished a full playthrough of Arx Fatalis. I wanted to come back and give my thoughts about it. So Arx Fatalis is an RPG that was released in 2002 by Arkane Studios, who are probably best known for Dishonored and Dark Messiah of Might and Magic, which were two very good games. This is obviously pretty far back in Arkane Studios' history as developers, all the way back to 2002, but you can really still see their skill and the talent that they have, even all the way back here. Now, it is a fairly flawed game. You could definitely tell they weren't as mature as developers as they are now. But despite that, it's a really, really good game. And frankly, I think it's a bit of a lost gem. It's not that nobody ever mentions Arx Fatalis, it's just that I don't feel like it's mentioned nearly as much as it should be. There are certain classic games that are mentioned all the time, things like Deus Ex and System Shock 2, but I feel like I would put this game up with any of those. It's just, it's really good. And I wish more people talked about it, because it's a freaking awesome game, so let's delve into why I think so. So where I'm at the moment, by the way, in the game is very, very near the beginning, so this is going to be light on any spoilers. Basically, the story is you're a dude who was trapped in a goblin prison, and you escape, and stuff happens. And that's kind of it for the beginning. So this is like 10 minutes after I just escaped, and I'm kind of like in the sewery kind of parts, trying to get back to the surface, although I should specify that the surface is not actually the surface of the planet, but rather just the highest level, level 1, because as it turns out, this entire game is actually set underground. Yeah, the entire game is underground. It's basically a massive dungeon crawl, I guess you could call it that. Basically, the sun has kind of died out, so anyone who goes up above is going to have a very hard time actually surviving because it's just really, really cold. It's a pretty interesting setting, and it's very cool to have a game that's basically constantly claustrophobic to one degree or another. Because you're just, yeah, I mean, look at this. Like, the ceiling is almost touching my head. And that's how it is for a lot of the game, because you're always underground. Yeah, it's really neat. So, trying to work my way up, trying to get myself out of this horrible place down here after I've just escaped from prison. As you can see, I'm not wearing much. I've got pants, and that's about it. I don't even have a weapon. So what is it about this game that makes me like it so much? Well, again, it has a lot of issues. And I think there's like a frog down here. Oh, it's a rat. And it's making super loud splashing noises, and I hate it, and I want to kill it. But I don't have a weapon. Damn it! Anyway. Again, it has a lot of problems, but what I like about it the most, I think, is how much it rewards exploration. And I don't mean just kind of monetarily, in terms of like giving you loot and gold and stuff like that. Let's check this body here. Ah, nothing on it. I'm looking for a weapon. I'll even take a bone. You can literally use a human bone as a weapon. Ah well, I'll find one at some point. Yeah, it just rewards exploration to an amazing degree. There's just so much stuff to find everywhere. There's so much stuff. So many cool and small things. Like, it's a game that really rewards looking in every single nook and cranny. It actually reminds me a hell of a lot of Dark Messiah, or not Dark Messiah, Vampire the Masquerade Bloodlines, which is another game that is, even today, even after all the patches and stuff, it's still kind of severely broken. It's a really messy game. Like, it's got so many issues. But, despite that, it's still an incredibly good game. And this reminds me of that, for the same reason, really. Like, the same thing that kept me playing Vampire the Masquerade Bloodlines is also the same thing that keeps me playing this game. In the sense that there's just like, I just want to look around every corner to find all the cool stuff. There's people to talk to and loot to get and just interesting things to find. And that reason alone, that motivation alone sustained me through the entire game despite so much of it being kind of mediocre or broken. but that element of it is just so strong. So here's one example I'll actually show you. It's a minor spoiler, but again, this is the very beginning of the game. So here's a kind of cool extra thing you can do. You can see there's this here, which appears to be some sort of a pressure plate. So if we move these stones off of here, that raises up. And there's a pressure plate at the other side of the room, so if we weigh this one down, there we go. Mess around with some pressure plates, and we have a secret room. Full of things. I know it's very dark. I don't have a torch, unfortunately. That's just the tutorial stuff, don't worry about that. Food and things and potions and wine or whatever that is, a key. An apple. What the hell? Oh god, it's a rat! It's not a nice rat, it wants to kill me. I don't have a weapon. Dear god, I don't have a weapon. Ah, no! Throw it at it! Ah! Take the chair! I need to close this. Close it! Before it gets out! No, it got out! Fuck! Alright, hold on. I need to put this rope on this thing. That stuff. Okay, goodbye! Haha! Okay, what the hell was I saying? Before I panicked?
Hi.
I honestly don't remember what I was saying. Rewarding exploration, I think I was talking about? Or the comparison to Vampire the Masquerade Bloodlines? Yeah, so Vampire the Masquerade Bloodlines. A very broken game, but incredibly entertaining to play. And I feel like it's very similar with this one. With Arx Fatalis. It's not quite as broken. It's not nearly as broken as Vampire the Masquerade, but it still is pretty broken, but it's just so freaking fun to play. There's just so many cool things to see. Oh god.
Me bring you back to cell now.
Aim at his head. Alright, well, I'll show you a little bit of the voice acting here, but the one problem is that I need to fight this guy and I don't have a weapon.
Die, you bastard!
I'm looking for a weapon. There's no weapon, is there? There's no weapon! Shit. Okay. Gonna have to feed him with punches.
Did you want fighting about?
Come here, you bastard! I'll get his back, you get his front! Whew!
Shagar, we got him!
Okay, so you can see some of the... this is one of the issues with the game, it's the horrible voice acting. It's got really bad voice acting, but it's actually kind of charming. Like, it's so bad, it's actually kind of hilarious, as you're about to hear. I believe I can talk to him.
Just after you went through the hole, I heard a noise. So I hid and waited till the goblin came in. This time I got the drop on him, sneaky bastard.
Okay, well that didn't sound too bad, but trust me, the voice acting is really, really bad. Lever in some money. Cool, cool. Warming yourself up there, I see. And there's just so many interesting things that you can do, so many interesting interactions. Like, there's an incredible amount of loot that you can get, and things that you can combine with other things. So, for example, if you get pieces of wood, you can use these as levers. If you find a switch like this that's missing its lever. Well, that's not good. You flip around switches, you can throw around objects all over the place. Let me find something to throw. Oh, we're going upstairs. Load the next level. Alright, so we just came from... Yeah, we were down on level 3, now I've moved up to level 2. I need something to throw.
You lose again.
You're lucky. Me play enough today.
Me got good joke for you.
Hey! Oh, human!
They spotted me. Alright, I'm gonna kill these dudes. Boy, take their weapons.
Help!
Okay, I finally have a weapon. There we go. Now I can finally defend myself. So yes, there's a lot of fun interactions you can do. Mess around with levers, you can throw objects any way you want. It's actually a surprisingly detailed kind of physics system. Obviously it's not super advanced physics, everything is kind of just a block that kind of awkwardly moves about, but still, just the fact that you can grab so many things and just throw it about is very cool. I mean, for a game that was released in 2002, like, I wouldn't expect these to be anything but static objects that can't be moved. But you can. And you can even move pillows, and you can find stuff under people's pillows all the time. Find money or keys and stuff like that. Gems. Oh, some torches, thank God. I can finally light up this place for you. So yeah, I can light torches. Shows up over here as being lit. It actually, the torch has limited durability. So it actually uses up the durability to have it lit. Throw around playing cards. Throw them into the air. They float awkwardly sometimes. It's a very wonky game, but it's just so cool. There's so much cool stuff you can do. You can even bake. You can freaking bake. You can actually combine flour with water and make dough. And then if you put the dough next to a fire, it actually rises. It starts to get bigger, and then it becomes cooked, and it becomes bread. And then you can take it and eat it. It's like, how freaking cool is that? It's really, it's unbelievably cool. And the stuff that you can do. This is where I escaped, actually. We, killed these dudes and then jumped down here. So yeah, there's just so much stuff to find. So many cool just levers and buttons and riddles and chests and things to locks to pick, and it's really unbelievable how much stuff there is. And that's what I like it for the most, I think. That's what I found most interesting about it, and it sustained me easily through enjoying the entire game. All 20 plus hours. Despite how wonky everything else is. So I guess let's talk about how wonky some of the other stuff is, because you're probably wondering what I'm talking about. So let's describe the combat system a little bit. You've seen it a little bit in action, but here's how it actually works. Kind of standard RPG thing, you have a weapon, it has durability and damage. In this case, this wooden club does 3 damage. You have directional attacks, so 4 different directions can be attacked in, kind of sort of like a mountain blade style, where if you start to move in a direction, it'll become a directional attack in that direction. So, for example, if I start to move to the left and then attack, then it's kind of like an attack to the left. If I start to move to the right and attack, it's like that. If I move back and attack, it's more of a stab. And forwards is an overhead. And you can charge up your attacks to make them do more damage. So if you look at the little light gem sort of thing at the center bottom of the screen, if you notice when I start to attack, it gets brighter if you wait. So if you wait until that's fully charged, then it does more damage. And something that really surprised me is that there's actually location-specific damage on enemies. So for example, if you hit them in the head, you can actually kind of knock off their head, like decapitate them. Or if you hit them in the arm, you might cut off their arm. Yeah, I didn't manage to do it there, but yeah, there is actually location-specific damage. Which is pretty cool. However, the combat system is not very good. It's not bad, it's just kind of clumsy and it's just not very good. Like, there's just not much there, it's not very interesting. It might seem cool with location-specific damage and charging up weapons and being able to attack from a bunch of different directions, but that really is it for the melee combat. Like, there's nothing more to it. It never gets any more interesting. I just broke my club. He automatically took out his other one. There's something I was gonna say. What was it? Oh yeah, there is also shields that you can get. However, it's not any sort of a kind of active blocking system where you need to like hold up your shield to time the blocks just right or anything like that. It's much more simple than that. It's just a all the shield does is just provide you a passive defense against attacks. This gives you a higher armor rating, armor class, and that's it. So, yeah, it doesn't really add any kind of interesting dimension to the combat.
Lords, attack!
Let's see if I can decapitate you. Nope. Oh, ew. I didn't mean to do that, but I guess I did just demonstrate the location-specific damage. I cut off his leg. Ew. Ooh, a torch. So, combat system is, it's okay, it's not very interesting. It's interesting at first, kind of, but then it very quickly becomes stale. There is also a magic casting system. I'll talk about that a little bit later.
Huh?
He heard me.
Here is human!
Come here. Now he's running away. No, he's not running away. And you may have noticed that the combat seems very easy. Let's drink this wine. And indeed it is. In fact, I did find combat a little bit difficult at first, just because you don't have any good weapons, you don't have any good armor. However, very shortly after the beginning of the game, it just got so incredibly easy that for almost the entire game, like after the first hour or two, combat was basically not even challenging at all. Like, virtually no challenge whatsoever. And I played a character that at first was a mixture of melee and magic.
Yeah.
But then after that I kind of morphed over into focusing just on magic. But regardless of, you know, which stage I was at, whether I was doing magic and melee or just magic, the game was still just so extremely easy. Challenge was never really anything that really mattered. Like, it wasn't even really present. It's like, oh, there's an enemy. Gotta press this button to cast this spell, and then they're dead. And that's it.
If you is come for trade.
Skip that. Do that later. So yeah, that's another problem it has. It just doesn't really have any challenge, to be frank. And it wasn't like I was using a character build guide, and I was creating, like, a completely overpowered character by following very specific instructions or something like that. Like, I didn't really distribute my stats for my character very well, to be honest. But nonetheless, I became ridiculously overpowered. To the point where I could kill almost virtually every enemy with one magic spell. So it's definitely a problem, but again, I enjoyed playing through the entire game just on the strength of the exploration alone. So the lack of challenge really wasn't that big of a deal. It's just kind of like, okay, an enemy's coming towards me, press this button, oh, they're dead. Okay, cool. It was more amusing than anything else. Some other stuff to mention. The quest log is really, really bad. It's, I suppose it's okay at the beginning. Pretty much tells you kind of what you need to do, but oftentimes it just doesn't tell you what the hell you've been doing or what you're really supposed to be doing at all. Which is a pretty common theme with this game. It really doesn't hold your hand at all, which is good for the most part. You know, a lot of more modern RPGs, or modern games of any sort, really, hold your hand to a ridiculous degree. And it doesn't do that, which is good, but I think they've gone a little bit too far in the other direction. Because there's quite a few times where I just had no damn clue what the hell I was even supposed to be doing, especially if I hadn't played the game for a little bit. And the quest log does a particularly bad job of reminding you what you've been doing and what, like, where you should even be looking. And as such, I pretty frequently had to go looking for walkthroughs to figure out what the hell I was supposed to be actually doing. The map is also pretty bad. Every level just looks like an indistinct blob of tan colors. And even after having played the game for 20 plus hours, and even when I was near the end of the game, I still had to think, when I was trying to think of, okay, I need to get to this place, and it's back on some level, and I was flipping through all the different levels looking for where it was. Even near the end of the game, I still had trouble locating stuff, because this map is just almost useless. Everything looks the same. It's not even exactly clear where the level transitions are, because they're these tiny little pixely little tags that are sometimes completely obscured by the kind of fog of war on the map. Like, that says level 2 there, if you can even tell, that says level 4. But some of them don't even really show up on the map. So it's like, you know, how do I get from this level to another one? Like, it's a mess. Another thing about the game I didn't care for very much is the story. So you start out as some guy in prison, but it quickly becomes the typical sort of fantasy you need to save the world sort of thing. You know, you are a very important person. And you have to save everybody else. You have to defeat evil and blah 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 and magic stones and whatnot. Like, it's super generic. There's nothing interesting going on with the story at all. And as I already mentioned, the voice acting is really bad, although to a kind of hilarious degree.
Hey, human!
Ooh, you have a sword.
Bastard.
I want that sword. It's way better than a club.
Fight like girl goblin.
Cut you head off!
You is fight like girl goblin!
There we go. Where did your sword go? Oh, there it is. It's floating in midair for some strange reason. Much better. Does 4 damage as opposed to 3. Also tends to have a lot better durability. So some other things. There are quite a few puzzles and riddles and stuff like that. Environmental puzzles and things of that sort. And often they're really interesting and really fun to do. That's part of how fun the exploration is. However, there are quite a few times, even in the main quest, in other words, stuff that isn't optional, stuff that you have to do to get through it, that isn't so good. As in, they're puzzles that have riddles and stuff that don't really make any damn sense, and the puzzles are just kind of annoying and just confused me, and I just ended up looking up walkthroughs to actually get through them. Because, well, I kind of had to, because they're part of the main quest and you have to do them. So that was unfortunate. They're just puzzles that, they're just not very well designed, and it doesn't help when the quest log isn't very good and your map isn't very good, so sometimes even just finding what you're supposed to be doing and where you're supposed to be doing it can be part of the challenge as well. It all kind of compounds in on itself and often leads to frustration. So I would definitely recommend keeping a walkthrough handy for this game, because there's quite a few times where it really should help you out more than it does. Okay, let's talk about the magic system, which is actually very interesting. Let's go to a saved game. Unfortunately, all my save games are from really late in the game. This is the only early save game I have, called Footsteps Oh My God. And there's a reason for that, by the way. But let's move on to later in the game. I don't want to spoil anything, I just want to show some of the magic. 12 hours... Find a good one. This should be fine. Where the hell am I? Yeah, this is fine. Okay. So this is one of the... sort of the lower levels. Here, I'll actually demonstrate just how ridiculously overpowered my character is, and how easy combat is. So this is a rat dude. I'm gonna cast a fireball spell. He is now dead. Oh, there's another one. He is now dead. Yeah. There really is not any challenge to the combat whatsoever. It's pretty ridiculous. So here's how the magic system works, by the way. It's actually quite unique. You actually have to draw runes. So there's this. You can draw pretty stuff. And what you're trying to draw are these runes. So there's a bunch of them. Hell of a lot of runes. Basically, when you get runes, you find them in the world and you have to actually use them, which adds them to your kind of rune book here. It automatically populates this list here with any spells that you can make from the current combination of runes that you have. So the more runes means the more spells you can make. So for example, this night vision one requires those two runes that you see down there. And once you, as soon as you get both of those runes over here on the right, night vision will then pop up in your spell book. So if I was missing at least one of those runes or both of them, then it wouldn't even show up. So get runes and get more spells. And then, to actually cast it, let's cast... I kind of want to cast Magic Missile, but I already know that it makes a very loud noise when you cast it, which kind of blows out your eardrums, so I don't want to scare anybody. Actually, all these spells kind of make super loud noises for some reason. Here, I'll try Heal. So those are the runes that I need to draw. If you click on a spell, it pops up in the top right, so you can use that as like a little guide. I'm going to cast this. open up this, and then we need to draw them. So the first one might look like it's kind of like a sideways thing, but it's actually not. It's actually a the fat end is where you start, the smaller end is where you end. So for the first one, it's just straight from the bottom to the top, just straight up like that. There we go. And then the second one is left to right, and then up. There we go. And then once you release this, it will actually cast it. So there's the healing spell cast. And yeah, just the same for all the others. Different combinations. Obviously, the kind of the harder spells tend to have longer combinations. Most of them are between 2 and 3. Different runes that you have to do. Not sure if there's any ones that require... there's one that requires 4. There's an incredible amount of spells. However, the problem with the spell system is that... well, you're not really going to cast most of these spells. I mean, you might try them out for fun, because, you know, you just got them and they're new and you want to know what they do. And there's so many of them. But the truth is, you're almost never going to cast any of these. In reality, what you're probably going to cast are things like Ignite, which will light up any torches around you. There's none around here that I can demonstrate that for. Actually, I can put this torch on the ground and cast Ignite. There we go. So you'll do stuff like casting Ignite. It'll be pretty common. You'll probably cast Heal occasionally. Fireball is probably going to be your go-to spell for most of the game. That's the one I just used to kill those Ratmen. Might want to try a couple things like Bless and Trap. And that's pretty much it. Like, there's basically like one or two spells that you're going to use all the time, and then there's maybe 3 or 4 spells that you're going to use occasionally, and then the rest you're basically never, ever, ever going to use. Most of these are just really wastes of space. Like, there's no reason to use them, they're more trouble than they're worth. And it's just really hard to cast this stuff. See, here's one of the key problems. Most of the time when you're casting this stuff, you're going to be using it during combat, right? Because most of the stuff is related to combat. It's to heal, it's to armor, lower armor, heal yourself, do damage, buff, debuff. Most of these are combat things. But the problem is, how are you going to remember how the hell to cast any of these things during combat? Like, I have to cast a fireball. I'm in combat. I'm kind of panicking. Oh yeah, I gotta remember. Keep in mind an enemy's attacking me while I'm doing this, and I gotta go like that, and then that, and then that, and then... and then I messed it up. So, oh god, I gotta do it again. Let's get it right. I'm still getting attacked, keep in mind. There we go. The problem is just that there's an incredible amount of spells. All these different combinations. It's hard to remember them. Even if you do remember them, you have to actually draw them. And the game's recognition of your drawings is not great. It's not very forgiving in terms of recognizing your shapes as the various runes. And in reality, you're going to get into combat and realize that trying to remember how to cast these spells and casting them fast enough during combat is just not really going to happen. So as such, despite how interesting the drawing the rune system is and all the different spells you can cast, it's just not going to work out that way. In reality, what you're actually going to do is something like casting Fireball, and that's pretty much all you're going to do for most combat situations. Because it kills everything in basically one hit. And what you're probably going to want to do is actually queue up the spell, because you can actually queue up to 3 spells. So if you notice, there's a little Fireball icon down here. That means I have 1 Fireball queued up. So I can... any spell that you want to cast, you can queue up simply by holding an extra key. So if you hold down Control, that opens up the standard spell casting thing, and then if you also hold Shift... so if you hold down both Control and Shift, that means that any spell you cast will be saved up. So if I want to do Fireball... this is going to add it to my queue down here. There we go. Yeah, so you're going to queue up 3 Fireballs, get into combat, cast them, and then after combat's over, do it again. And that's it. So the magic system is interesting to begin with, but then you realize in practice, most of it doesn't really matter. So It's kind of a shame. It really just doesn't work. Like, they were obviously envisioning you doing lots of cool, crazy stuff. There's all sorts of things, like raised dead and paralyzed and whatnot, but most of this stuff just doesn't matter. Like, it's not worth the effort of trying to remember how to cast it. When you have something like Fireball, which basically solves every combat situation ever, pretty much. So, again, interesting, but it doesn't really work out. Now, let's go show something really cool. And that's the reason for why I named this Footsteps Oh My God. And that's because this game's sound design, when it comes to the character movement, is exceptional. I mean, the sound design of this game in general is not exceptional. In general, it's just decent. With special mention to how horribly mixed some of the spells are. For some reason, a lot of the spells you shoot just come out, like, 200 times louder than everything else in the entire game. Which you might have kind of heard with the fireball. A lot of spells are just really loud. However, the character's movement sounds are ridiculously good. They not only sound good on their own, but they also vary based on what kind of a surface you're walking on. Which is not something I really expected to hear for a game released in 2002. I wasn't expecting so much detail. But here, have a listen to my footstep sounds. So yeah, there's three different footstep sounds right here, based on whether you're on stone, on this kind of like sandy dirt stuff, or on metal. I'm really amazed how much the walking sounds vary based on the environment that you're walking on, and it sounds so good! The footsteps are just so ridiculously good sounding. And here's something else, by the way. What your footsteps sound like actually vary based on what you're wearing. So right now I'm kind of wearing... I'm not kind of, I'm definitely wearing leather leggings. However, if you take these off, your footstep sounds actually change. Yeah, so you can hear your footsteps padding around. Since it's just your bare feet touching the ground. And if you put it back on, like, how cool is that? And then later on, when you get stuff like chainmail leggings, then when you walk around, you start to hear, like, the clinking of your chainmail as you walk. Like, there's an incredible amount of variety to the walking sounds, and it varies all depending on what you're actually walking on and what you're wearing. It's really, really cool. I know, I guess that's a relatively small thing. It probably seems like, but I actually think it's really important, because this is a game where you're going to be traveling all over the place, right? I mean, that's what you're going to be doing all the time, is walking. So I think it's especially important that they get the walking sounds, get them down and get them sounding good, because you're going to be hearing this constantly. And they freaking nailed it. Like, sometimes it doesn't even matter where the hell I'm going, it's just fun to listen to my footstep sounds, which is really a testament to how good the sound design is for the character's movement. It's very cool. So yeah, I guess that basically sums it up. It's got a lot of problems, it's really weak in a lot of areas. It's often very obtuse, I guess you could say. It doesn't help you out a lot. It goes a little bit too far into the opposite direction of holding your hand, to the point of almost being sadistic sometimes. So a walkthrough is definitely recommended for any sections where you're particularly stuck. It's weird. It's funny. It's got really bad voice acting, but it's kind of hilariously bad. The story is also kind of hilariously generic. It's got a lot of issues, but it also has so many damn cool things. It's got amazing character movement sounds. It's a game that tries to pack in so many ideas. And a lot of them it doesn't execute very well. But just the fact that it tries those ideas makes it really fascinating to watch and to play. There's just so many things you can do. Again, you can bake. You can make apple pie. You can actually make apple pie. You can throw around objects. There's potion making. Like, you can find all these things like water lilies and medicinal herbs and whatnot, and you can grind those up in a mortar and pestle. Turn them into a powder, and then actually mix them into a potion. So there's potion making, there's food that you can make, you can eat food and drink wine. You can even cook fish, which is something that I'd love to demonstrate, but I don't have any uncooked fish, unfortunately. But you can actually cook fish, so if you get a raw fish, you can actually put it right next to the fire. And it'll actually start to sizzle, and then turn into a cooked fish, like this one is. So there's just so many cool things you can do. And again, it mostly comes down to that, how much it rewards exploration. Again, not just monetarily, because the game's economy is actually horribly messed up. I played through and I was kind of a moderate pack rat. I saved most of the stuff I found, you know, I picked up any enemies, weapons that I found and sold them at the shop. But I wasn't crazy about it. But nonetheless, when I ended the game, I had so much money. Like, it was probably only about 25% through the game that I... It probably only took me about 25% through the game to get to the point where I didn't even need money at all. Like, finding gold in a chest didn't mean anything to me because I had so much money that there's literally nothing I could spend my money on. Nothing. Not a single thing. Not even the most, like, vain, expensive thing. I couldn't even buy, like, gold pants or something. Nothing. I looked desperately for anything I could possibly spend my money on, even just as a joke, and there was nothing. Like, you can get money so ridiculously easily that it's not even funny. So very quickly, money and combat becomes not even an issue. Like, there's really no challenge to this game in terms of dying. But there is a challenge in terms of puzzles and in terms of figuring out all the cool stuff that you can find. And that is what's really fun. Is just finding all these things, just like baking stuff and finding levers and finding combinations and just exploring a dungeon. Like, there's so much detail. To the point where I've spent about an hour in a dungeon before. And after that hour, I found that I've only moved like I haven't even explored a fourth of the dungeon after an hour. Because everything is just so dense. You know, I find a key that unlocks a chest, I go into the chest and I find a note and that's a clue to another thing, and then there's a lever, and then I use the lever and I find out the lever like unlocks covers a spike pit on the other side of the whole dungeon, then I go there and that leads to another thing. It's like, it's insane. There's just so much cool stuff to find. It's really amazing. I also want to mention that if you intend to play this game, which I would definitely recommend, then I would also recommend the Arx Libertatis patch, which is actually based on the game's source code that was fairly recently released, which was a very cool thing for the developers to do and something that doesn't happen often enough. It does lots of good things, like making the game more compatible with modern computers, I believe it even adds support for Linux, and fixes a bunch of bugs and all sorts of good stuff like that. So I'll have a link to Arx Libertatis in the description. And Arx Fatalis itself is also available from Steam and GOG. Links to those will also be in the description. So that is Arx Fatalis. It's a gem from the past that I really think more people should experience.